finer subdivisions. So we shall prove some existence theorem here. This kind of things you must have used several times for the interval. Take an open interval, take a closed interval, and take an open covering. Then there is a finer subdivision such that each interval is contained in one of the open sets. So that is, you can term as subdivision finer than the open covering. So this is what we are going to now generalize. Two simplicial complexes and barycentric subdivisions. Okay. Let K be any simplicial complex. Okay. First, let me introduce these notations, which will be quite useful elsewhere also. Let us look at all the points inside mod K which can be joined by a single line segment to this V vertex. Okay, so that is going to be a star-shaped set. So we are going to define this star V, except that it's going to be the open star. Star of V is defined all points alpha in mod K, such that alpha when evaluated at V is not zero, that's all. In particular, you know the vertex V is identified with the map which takes 1 at V and 0 at everywhere, all our other vertices. So vertex V is there in this star V. Okay. So if alpha V is not 0, T times alpha plus 1 minus T times V, this entire line will be also inside. Will have say beta of that will be also not zero, so all of them will be inside the star V. Okay, in any case, because it is defined by a open condition, something is not zero, one coordinate is not zero, those coordinate functions are continuous functions after all. The star V is an open subset of mod K, and it will contain all the points if you vary the vertices V, because for each alpha, somewhere alpha will be non-zero. So it will belong to one of the stars in any case. So this is an open cover for mod K. A cover is finer than another cover, which just means that every member in the first cover must be contained in some member in the second cover. This is a general topological notion. Okay. We say a simplicial complex itself is finer than an open covering U of the mod K if these star Vs, this is another open covering for mod K, this must be finer than the given covering U. Okay, so instead of coverings, we are defining K itself is finer than U, which is just a short terminology to tell that star V is finer than U. Okay, just that means that for each V, there is some UV inside this curly U, such as star V is contained inside U. Every member in this covering must be contained in some member in U. Now we take the case, special case, name K is finite. In particular, the vertex set is also finite, okay. Then look at the definition of mod K as a subspace of I raised to V, or you can just write as V is finite, I raised to some N, where N is a number of vertices in K. Okay, it's a Euclidean space. We can take the restriction of the Euclidean metric, okay, on this I cross N times. Okay, namely, distance between X and Y is just square root of the sum of the squares of the differences of xi and yi, xi minus yi. So that's the Euclidean distance. All right. The two topologies coincide because k is finite. This is what you should recall. Only when k is infinite, we are giving a finer topology on mod k. Even if you define that way, this is going to be the same topology. That is the whole idea. Special property of this metric is, okay, is the following. Namely, it's a linear metric in some sense. What is that some sense? Restricted to each mod f, it is given by a norm. You see, if you take I power v, it is not a vector space. Mod k is far from that thing. But inside k, you know, it's a linear metric restricted to each mod f. It's linear in the sense that if you take alpha, if you say some t times alpha and t times beta, the distance between them will be mod t times the distance between alpha and beta. Okay, so it is given by the norm there. Because mod f has affine structure. So you can take the affine linear space there and talk about the distance between two points is the same thing as norm of the difference. Okay, so that's very easily verified because this is the Euclidean metric. I'm going to use that in the sense that distance between some multiple t times alpha, t times beta, is mod t will come out. So that's what I can use here. The first lemma is an elementary calculus kind of thing here. Namely, k is a finite simplicial complex. I repeat it. D is the metric that we have taken. Okay. Any other metric which has linear property will also do the same thing. That is why I have put it as linear metric. Then, okay, D is a linear metric on the barycentric subdivision also. And for any f prime belonging to SD of K, okay, SD of K, f prime is FD of K, such that f prime is contained inside mod f. This f prime is some finite subset, it's all that thing. F prime contained in mod f. Where f itself is a simplex, q simplex. We have the following inequality of diameters. The diameter of f prime will be less than or equal to q divided by q plus 1 times diameter of f. What is q? Q is a dimension of the f here. So take a simplex of whatever size inside SD of K, but FT must be contained inside mod f, that means its dimension will be also less than or equal to that. That will follow because of the chain condition is there. Na? So where f belongs to K, it's a Q simplex, then we have this inequality. So you can see that the diameter of the smaller things, after all, is controlled by this factor. This is definitely a number which is smaller than 1, so of the diameter of F, at least this much. Okay, for example, if you take q equal to 2, namely a triangle, then this will say it is really two-third each of the one of the six triangles that you have divided into a triangle into will have diameter less than equal to two-third of the original diameter. If q is 1, namely the simplex, namely the one simplex, then what is this one? This is 1 by 2. It's actually equal, you can see. Right? Take a one simplex, what are the one chip practice of the subcomplex SD of the barycentric subdivision, 0 to half and half to 1. So each of them has length half, whereas the diameter, original diameter, is 1. So that is the meaning of this one. Okay, I have given you examples for simple cases, but in general, this is what it is. So having stated this one, this can be left as an exercise completely. But since this kind of things are not done in, even in elementary linear algebra or calculus or even in topology, so let me do it here. Okay, it is not all that easy, not completely easy. Okay, so let us have a notation: F equal to V naught V1 V2. These are the vertices. For any point alpha in mod F, okay, we can think of this as a convex combination of Ti Vi. This is the definition by alpha equal to Ti Vi. Summation Ti equal to 1 and 0 less than Ti equal to 1. Okay. Now take any other beta inside F, then we have distance between alpha and beta is distance between summation Ti Vi and beta. I can write beta also summation some Sj Vj, but I'm just keeping it for a while. Okay. This distance, the same thing as distance between Ti Vi. So you can take summation Ti, which is 1, just multiply by that one for formally. Okay. Now you have two summations here. Okay. And this summation, this distance is same thing as distance between norm of this minus this. So that's what I'm using. That this distance is given by the norm, because both of them are inside mod F. Okay. So what is this? I take norm of this summation minus this summation. You can rewrite it as Ti times Vi minus beta. Here it times beta, right? So Ti times Vi minus beta summation. Norm of the sum, okay, is less than or equal to sum of the modulus. This is the, these are the norms again. Vi is our vertices, vector, beta is also vector. So it's norm of summation less than summation of the triangle inequality I'm using is. Ti comes out of the norm because Ti's are all non-negative. Okay, so it's norm of Vi minus beta. But now this is summation Ti of distance between Vi and beta. Okay. Right? Very simple computation. Now, how to use this one? Therefore, distance between alpha and beta is less than or equal to supremum of all these distances. Take the maximum, this finite, supremum is same thing as maximum. If I put a maximum for each of them and take Ti, summation Ti will be 1. So it will be less than good that one. If I put maximum, this will be less for less than, no. If this is already less than good, this one, it will be less than. And we put each Di Vi by the maximum. But summation Ti is 1. So now it becomes maximum. Maximum is just supremum. Okay, what is the meaning of this one geometrically? Take any simplex like this and take any point beta and any point alpha, the distance between alpha and beta is smaller than the distance between beta and any one of the vertices. Take the maximum of that. Largest distance between, go all the way to one of the vertices. So one point I have kept fixed, the other point I have replaced by vertices. Now I want to do the same thing, apply it. This is also a point after all. Now you do it for beta also. Reverse this, you know, this is symmetric relation. So use this one. What I get is, since this is true for all alpha and beta, you can put beta equal to Vj and take alpha equal to beta in this one. Distance between beta and Vj less than equal to supremum of distance between Vi and Vj. This is true for all betas and for all Vj, all j's. So what does it mean? Distance between any point in the vertex and vertices is smaller than the maximum of the, what are these? These are edges, length of the edges of the simplex. Therefore, if you maximize the left hand side, what do you get? This is for all Vj's is true. Each of them is true. See, from here you can go to this inequality. Alpha beta is less than or equal to this one, and each of them less than or equal to this one. So distance between alpha and beta from 12 and 13 is less than the supremum of distance between Vj and Vj. Now take the maximum here. If for everything it is less than or equal to this one, the maximum will be also less than or equal to this one, or supremum. This supremum is nothing but diameter of F by definition. So the diameter of F is actually realized in the length of one of the sides. Maybe if I stated this right in the beginning, you would have understood it very clearly. So this is easy to see for triangles. Easy means what? If you want to write down the full proof, will be like this. But I have done it for any simplex now. Okay. Now, let u1 and u2 be any two vertices of f prime, simplest f prime, in SD of f. Without laws of generality, we may write u1 by changing the labeling, u1 as v0 plus v1 plus vk divided by k plus 1, where this is a k simplex. And u v2 is v0 plus v1 plus vm, m plus 1. Okay, so we can assume M is bigger than K or K is bigger than M. So I will assume K is less than M less than M. I want these two are distinct vertices, not the same. Okay, this is just by labeling, I assume. Here, some of them are repeated. Okay, V naught and Vk, but that's also not necessary. You could have arranged this way. Then distance between u1 and u2 will be less than or equal to supremum of distance between one. I am taking u2 is this one. U2 I am keeping fixed, but I am rearing all the this one here. Supremum of Vs. Vs are these things, one less than or equal to zero, less than or equal to s, less than or equal to primum. This is maximum of this one. Okay. Distance between Vs and U2. So this is by our earlier observation. Okay. Similar to that one. I don't have to do it again. But this I am going to do carefully now. Distance between Vs and U2. Just write down. It's norm of Vs minus. What is U2? So U2 has this expression. I will use this one. 0 to m vr divided by m plus 1. So I pull out m plus 1. So multiply vs by m plus 1, take minus 0 to m vr. So there are m plus 1 quantities here, right? The beauty here is that one of the vs at least will be equal to vr, right? So less than equal to 1 divided by m plus 1. 0 to m vr minus vs is fixed, okay, r is ranging here, vr. So you will get at most, you know, m of them. So 0 less than 1, m divided m plus 1, supremum of dvr vs, 0 less than equal to r. Okay, so that is how your m divided m plus 1 will come. There are m of them. Take the supremum for all of them now, distance. But how many are there? Only m of them is there. One of them is zero. That is the beauty. Hence, distance between u1 and u2 it starts from you and you to here. It is supremum of these things. When each of them is less than or equal to this one, so even you to itself is less than or equal to this diameter. But this M is smaller than Q, right? Because they are all inside F. So if M is smaller than Q, smaller or equal to, M divided M plus 1 is smaller than Q divided Q plus 1. Okay, so this is monotonically increasing equation. So all of them are less than Q divided Q plus 1 diameter. So this is a rough estimate. So we have proved this statement. Now, take K as a finite superficial complex and you be any open covering for mod K. Then, if you divide K sufficiently number of times, so SD of N is nothing but SD of K, SD of that, SD of that, and so on, K times. That will be finer than this open covering. Okay, so this SD of N is iterated subdivision. By definition, SD of SD of N. You can define SD 0 as is K itself. Okay. So here I am using the standard result on any compact set. If we have a open covering, compact metric space, is a metric space also, right? There is a Lebesgue number. The Lebesgue number is such that if you take any ball of diameter and any set of diameter less than equal to C, it will be contained in one of the open set. Okay, so start with an open covering, choose C to be the Lebesgue number for that covering. Then choose this capital in such that for all F prime in this one, we have diameter of F prime less than C by 2. So why this is possible? If you divide once, it will be, see, N is a finite, K is a finite simplicial complex. So it has one dimension. The dimension you can assume it's Q. Then diameter of the first subdivision will be less than Q to Q divided by N. If you repeat it, it will be Q into Q divided by Q plus Q divided by Q plus 1 raised to N times. But this number with powers of this one goes to 0. Okay, this can be made less than C by 2 by choosing little n to be sufficiently large. So that large n is this n. Once the smaller diameter is smaller, then what happens to any star? A star, okay, is contained in the union of all these simplexes which have one common vertex, right? So diameter of the star will be at the most twice that. That's why I have put C by 2. Once the diameter of each of them is less than C, the diameter of the star will be less than C by 2. Therefore, every star which is of diameter C will be contained inside one of the open sets. Okay. Subdivisions give the same topological information on the original triangular space because the homeomorphism type is the same, right? You don't change. In some way, we may say that they give same combinatorial information as well, but you have to be careful there. Based on the fact that two partitions of an interval have a common refinement, so this combinatorial information is also not lost, you may say. Okay. We can ask the question, given any two triangulations K1, K2 of a same space X, let us assume that X is compact. Are there subdivisions K1 prime and K2 prime of Ki such that these subdivisions are isomorphic? So this is true for subdivisions of an interval. if you have two different divisions, you can take a common refinement, right? So you can ask similar question for the subdivisions. Of some years, some subdivision you have taken, then you can ask this question. But these things are questions for arbitrary subdivisions, which I have not discussed. Okay, I am just telling you some story here, that's all. So two given triangulations space are said to be combinatorially equivalent if there is a common subdivision to both of them. So you can reformulate this question claiming that are they combinatorially equivalent. So this simple question was solved by Milner sometimes in 1961. Okay, he cooked up a new invariant for homeomorphism, invariant for this one, and showed that there are two simplicial complexes with different structures for this one. They have different invariants, so you can't subdivide them to get a same isomorphic subdivisions. Okay, but for manifolds less than Ricoh dimension 3, this is a deep theorem which has a positive answer. So all these things are a big branch of mathematics. I am just trying to tell you the awareness of there is a lot of mathematics under these things. Okay. So I have listed a few exercises. You can go through this one. As I keep telling you, these things will be again recirculated to you separately, so you don't have to know all these things. But I will just introduce one more concept here. You are not going to study this one very deeply right now, but it's a very, very important concept. What is it? It's a combinatorial concept. It goes back to Euler, so it's called Euler characteristic. What is it? Look at a simplicial complex. Just count the number of vertices, number of edges, number of two simplexes, three simplexes, and so on. So that is called Fi of k. Fi of k is the number of I simplexes of k. Okay, take the alternative sum. That is called the Euler characteristic of k. So this is some integer, positive, negative integer, one doesn't know. Okay, this very interesting geometric content is there. Okay, and it has lots and lots of applications and many different and very, very serious formulation of this one. I had simple ideas from here, but you must have heard of Atiyah-Singer index theorem, Riemann-Hurwitz formulas, and various, they're all involved with this one. Okay, so when time permits, slowly we will develop this one. And there are some simple exercises here based on the Euler characteristic. That's why I've introduced that one here. When time permits, we will do all these things in more detail. Okay, so we will stop here.